About extending the reach of ArcGIS through FME technology. My name is Dale Lutz. I'm a Vice President and Co-Founder of Safe Software. I'm joined today by
Mita Hajirakar.
Mita leads our FME desktop support group, and if some of you have listened in on the ArcGIS data interop forums, Mita chimes in from time to time there as well. And not just Mita and I who will be presenting, but we're joined by a whole host of other Safe Software members. We've got Laura Kirstens from our support team, Mark Stokes, leader of our professional services, and Robin Rennie, our product support specialist, particularly on the ArcGIS side, and they're standing by ready for you to pepper them with questions as the webinar goes along. So please don't hesitate to ask them things that are related or not, and at the very end we'll do a little summary of some of the questions that, came up. So just a few words of introduction about SAFE. If you've not heard of us, we've been around since 93, and we're from Vancouver, BC, Canada, the home of the, I guess, cellar-dwelling BC Lions football team. And I've got my jersey on today because we've got a big game today against Winnipeg, which I'm not very hopeful about. But anyway, and I know my American friends are happy today because the NFL is going to be back in business as well. So there may not be a debt ceiling agreement, but at least there'll be football later on this fall there. So we're excited about that here. We have about 90-ish employees and the global reach of resellers all around the world. And what it doesn't say on this slide is that we've been an ESRI partner of some sort or another since 1996. And on the OEM side, we've been working with them on the data interoperability extension, or data interop, or even interop for quick reference, since 2005. And as we proceed with today's webcast, we'll be showing you what I'm calling FME technology. That means the things we show you apply equally to the interop extension or FME itself. You can buy FME from Safe Software, you buy the interop extension from Esri. Safe is happy no matter where you buy, as long as you buy, and if you want to buy them both, that's good with us as well. So FME technology allows you to do what we call achieving total spatial data mastery. And said another way, our technology lets you put data in its place, puts you in control, removes the power that data formats and data models used to have over you that might have prevented you from getting done what you need to do. When we started at SAFE, the industry felt, I remember reading a paper saying that 60% of all time spent in a GIS project was around gathering and preparing the data, and only 40% was actually doing the real work. And so our technology lets you squeeze that front 60% down to say 5%, 10%. I mean, the goal of our technology is to have you not spend time in it, to get the job done quickly so you can move on to using, in this case, ArcGIS, to do the real work you want to do. So it looks like we're doing our first poll, and I know in BC we're excited about polls. We have a referendum, a mail-in one going on right now, so is Aaron going to take it away here and do something? So Aaron, what's going on? Which poll is going? There it is. Ah, we want to find out what kind of products of ours you're actually using currently. So please let us know. Tell us how much you've used either FME or the data interop, and we'll let that poll run for a bit. And Aaron's watching the results pouring in. How's it looking, Aaron? Are people there voting?
Yeah, we're getting close to about 80% here.
They've got their ballots in the mail?
That's right.
Okay.
There we go. I'll show the results.
Okay, so 40% of you haven't used it yet, so that's good, because this webinar is actually targeted as a pretty introductory webinar. We've done more that are kind of in-depth, and as you see when you get into this, there's a lot of depth in the data interop and in FME that we can get into, but today we're going to try to skim the surface and give you a good solid intro. And if I look there, we also have, I guess, a chunk of you, a quarter almost, that have been using it for a long time. You might learn a few tricks and pick up a few things as well. Thanks very much for letting us know. That's exciting. I guess we have to hide the results. Good. Okay, we're back. All right, so this looks like we're actually a TV show 60 Minutes. But that 60 minutes actually just means that's how long we'll be going in total, and I've used up 5 of it already, so it's only 55 minutes, of which, though, the last 5 or so will be a recap of interesting questions and any other discussion that comes up. But just broadly, we're going to take a quick intro to what our technology is about. We'll look at how the format support is used inside of ArcGIS to let us directly read non-ESRI format. So it's kind of a transparent extension of ArcGIS, so you can instantly, without any fuss or muss, read any data format that is supported. We'll kick that up to look at the quick import and export functionality, again, part of geoprocessing in ArcGIS with the data interop or the FME. Then we get into the part that I think is the most interesting, the ETL tool, the ability to transform quickly data between wherever it is and wherever we want it to be. We'll look at how you can use this technology with ArcGIS Server. And just as an enticement to have you stick it out to the bitter end, we will show at the very end, we'll try actually having me do a little demo. We'll see how that works on my Mac running a virtual machine to show ArcGIS 10.1 with the data interop at 10.1, doing a little bit of LiDAR and point cloud and showing you how that all fits together. We're pretty excited about how that's going to look. And at the end as well, we'll be looking to give away, 60 seats. I've never seen that many in one before. So anyway, you can keep that in mind. At the end, we'll be asking you if you're interested in training for the FME desktop. And I will say that whether you use the data interop or FME, it doesn't really matter. That training that you'd receive there is equally applicable in both cases. Wow, I think some of them can actually come here to our beautiful site in Surrey, British Columbia, where today it's actually sunny. This, I think, is our third sunny day of 2011, and you never know, you might get to enjoy that if you want to. So I think with that, let's look. Mita, would you like to talk about these demos?
Sure, yeah. I'm going to get pretty heavily into the FME ESRI extension here. And like Dale said, we're going to definitely hit the quick import and quick export. I'm going to do a number of demos in the FME ETL tools as well.
Well, you're going to look at some like translation. Some of the things there do, at first blush, it may look as though it overlaps with Model Builder, but really the FME ETL tools come in at a level below. And so really a lot of things you might do with an FME ETL tool, you'd otherwise have to be rolling up the sleeves and using Python, or maybe you couldn't even do it at all without writing a bunch of actual code. Mm-hmm. So in terms of what FME technology is all about, there's really four things that we would highlight. Of course, one of them is just erasing the format barrier. So in the oldest of days, if you would get some data in Swedish Mazik, and I should throw that out there, if anybody out there from Sweden is dialed in, if you can tell me what Swedish Mazik is about, I'll make it worth your while. So I don't see the questions. the question thing isn't lighting up, so there mustn't be a lot of Swedish Mazik fans. But if you had Swedish Mazik data, you just couldn't do anything with it. And so the first thing that we erase with our technology is the format barrier, so you can get in there and use your Swedish Mazik or any of the 250 formats. You can transform the spatial data. So if the data model that you're using for your local government isn't the data model that you've received data in, you can easily transform things by rearranging columns, adjusting geometry, that sort of thing. That's what that's about. Integrating different data types. We can pull them together from any of these ones listed in this cloud here and inject them into one output. So we can bring some BIM information and add some CAD to that and output it into some 3D information in our geodatabase. And of course, we would be remiss without mentioning XML. For those of you that know much about safe software, the other co-founder, Don Murray, is, I think, the self-appointed president of the XML Lovers Club. And I'd love to see how many out there are also interested in XML. Chime in right now, and we'll let Don know. It'll brighten up his holiday, I'm sure. But we do a fantastic job in the data interop and in FME with XML. Somebody's asked, like, see, if, what do we do with OSGB? That's, I'm sure, the Ordnance Survey of Great Britain, the master map. Yes. All that master map stuff is fully supported. We can read it all. And in fact, you can even use FME to write it. It's a bit harder to write it, but that's it. So I see the people pouring in with their XML love. Whoops, somebody says that Don must be nuts. Thanks very much, Bruce. We won't do that. Oh, Multispeak's coming in because that's another one of these XML formats. And definitely, I know Mark Stokes loves Multispeak. He also loves CIM as well, CIM.
I wouldn't say love.
He has a relationship with those things. So anyway, we can bring all those things together. Actually, I will mention while we're on this slide too, I just received word from our Australian friends last night that in the 10.1, in terms of format support, ArcPad is going to be added as an input source. And I'd love to know if any of you out there work with ArcPad AXF. And if you want to just chime in and let us know we're going to have reading out of the gate, but eventually we'll also be able to do writing, and that'll be in the Interop 10.1 as well as FME. And lastly, I just would say that this technology lets you share data with users when and how they need it, so we can use it to take the stuff that's in your ArcGIS and get it out to them as they need it. Oh, it's time for another poll. Oh, Inspire data, somebody said. Yes, ETL is a big deal with Inspire, and if you're working with that, for sure, it's important. So just to understand your situations better, we're asking you a question about your geodatabases, and are the polls open? Okay, so let us know where your geodatabase sits atop of, and that's always interesting. There are always minor variations in how things operate for us. We've supported these databases both natively and through geodatabase for many years now, and I know Mita loves supporting geodatabase on top of these things. Probably not as much as Robin, though. So if you want to stump Robin, you can say, look at that Oracle Spatial. Neck and neck, actually, with SQL Server. So SQL Server certainly very, very popular. And PostGIS certainly can't be taken for granted either. The other, those of you that answered other, if you can just write in the question thing to give us a clue about what that is, that would be very helpful for us to know as well. Okay.
Okay. All right, so I'm going to get into the demos now. But before I do that, I just want to briefly chat about what you can expect from the FME extension from ArcGIS once it's enabled. So first, you benefit from an increase in the number of data formats you can work with. We call this extending your format reach. For example, with this extension, you could easily use map info data directly within your ESRI applications. You could view the data, import it, and export it to a geodatabase or transform it in various ways. So I'm going to demonstrate now two ways for viewing data in ArcCatalog, through navigating in the catalog tree and using the FME connections node. But before I do that, let's just confirm that the FME extension for ArcGIS is enabled. And there we have it, and it's actually extended by our latest FME 2011 Service Pack 3, which happens to be this build number here.
Right, and I'll just chime in that if you have the Data Interop extension, that's what you'd see there. It would say Data Interoperability extension. But the key thing is, if you want to do this magic, you've got to have it enabled.
Right. Okay, now, as Dale said, without any fuss or muss, you can now directly read data from other non-ESRI file-based formats by simply navigating the catalog tree. So here I have my FME data folder. I have a number of data sets here in this folder. So let's navigate over to some City Parks data. This happens to be in Map Info tab format. Notice I've got the preview here. I can identify the features. I can take a look at the table view as well. So all the functionality available in ArcCatalog is available just by navigating through the catalog tree to non-ESRI formats.
So I can issue a warning that during this part there may be gratuitous, a viewer warning, this is gratuitous use of different data formats.
Yes, gratuitous.
So some viewers may find that a bit offensive.
Well, how about some KML, Dale? Let's take a look at some KML.
Shouldn't be offensive to too many people.
We've got some bird nest data here. So
bird nest
locations comes up very easily. It's as if you're viewing ESRI data, actually. You wouldn't even know you're viewing other data. What else? Let's take a look at some map info MIF data. We've got a number of parcels files. We're actually going to be working with a lot of this data, the properties data, in the upcoming demos. And finally, how about some Idrisi format data? Ever heard of Idrisi, Dale?
I have, actually.
Yeah, so there we go. We've got some point data.
You can't even tell that it's not an ArcGIS format.
Mm-hmm.
So there's like literally dozens, if not hundreds, of these that would just automatically be read.
Yeah, okay. So, as you've seen, it's a very simple and effective way of examining data in a non-ESRI format. To be clear, we're not translating the data, we're not moving it about, we're just reading it directly from a non-ESRI source. Now let's take a look at some DGN data. So in my community plan folder here, I've got some community plan-based map data. Now notice that the DGN data is grouped by geometry here. Users familiar with DGN know that the data is stored on levels, and each level has a number or name. So how can we view the community plan data grouped by level, number, or name instead of by geometry? Well, we can do this by setting up an FME connection to the data.
Right. So what's going on is that what we're seeing there is the built-in CAD reading that's in ArcGIS. Mm-hmm. But you can, in addition, the interop does also provide an FME provider way of getting at that. Is that what you're going to show us?
Exactly. So through the FME connections node now. So the FME connections node allows you to create an explicit connection to your data. Now the benefits to this are you can override the default read settings for any particular formats. We'll do that in a second. You can read from non-file based formats such as a database or a WFS feed, or you can read multiple data sets at one time so they can be viewed as one contiguous set.
Are you going to show us that?
I'm going to show you guys all of those.
All of those?
Yeah.
Wow.
Yeah.
We didn't rehearse this ahead, so it's as new to me as it is to you.
Okay, so let's get into the FME connections node now. So remember the community plan base map data. We're going to read that again, and this time we're going to see the actual level names. So down at the bottom here, you've got your FME connections.
Right, and if you had the data interop, it would say interop connection.
Exactly. So if I double-click below that to the add FME connection, you get this dialog box here. All you need to do is enter your format and enter where that data set is located. So my format is a MicroStation V8 format. And I'm now going to navigate to where that community plan DGN file is. So that was in my data folder and that one there. So those are the basic settings now. Now if I hit OK here, you would get the default way this data is read, which is actually by level number. But like I said, we want to read by level name. And to change the way this reader functions, you would actually hit the parameters button and notice that there are a number of parameters that affect the way this data can be read. All we're going to do is group by level names right up top here.
You know, I was thinking that old timers like me might prefer numbers, but it does seem that modern young folks like mm-hmm. yourself might prefer names. I bet you could set this as a default down at the bottom
yes,
so that forevermore
exactly.
it would always be there. But I won't ask you to do that right now.
Okay.
But I'll just say if you're not kind of, because numbers might not be as good as names.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
So you're going to go for names.
I'm going to go for names.
Wow.
I'm hit OK. Hit OK once more. Notice now we have a new FME connection here. I expand that. Take
Whoa.
A look. We've got buildings, rail, rivers, roads, and schools.
Wow.
So now I actually know what my data means when I take a look at it.
Wow,
okay.
There's a lot of it, too.
Yeah. Okay, so now let's take a look at the next demo. So remember I said you can view non-file-based formats, such as databases, with the add FME connection functionality here. So we're going to take a look at some Oracle spatial data. So again, I'm going to click Add FME Connection. I'm now going to pick my Oracle Spatial.
Wow, there's a lot of databases
reader.
There.
There's lots of them in here. So there's the Oracle Spatial.
No wonder
project.
Our database team is always busy. I didn't realize how many are in the list.
Yeah. Here we go. And of course, I need to enter connection information if I want to connect to Oracle. So I go into the parameters here. I enter my connection details. And now I can click on this button next to Table List and bring up the tables in that Oracle database. So I'm just going to take a look at the bus routes here and hit OK through all these dialogues.
This would be a good place where you could save the defaults, I suspect.
Yes, definitely. Yes, save your connection information. You have to type all the time. Okay, so here we go. We've got some line work here. I actually have to zoom in here to take a look at this. So let's zoom in a couple of times here. And
oh,
now
wow.
we have
okay.
bus routes from our Oracle Spatial database.
And that would work for any of these databases.
Exactly, exactly.
Right.
Okay, and the third demo I'm going to do with the add FME connection is to view multiple files at once. So let's actually go into Windows Explorer here. And I just want to quickly show you guys some DWG files in the water folder. So notice there's a number of them here. And I'm going to read a bunch of those at once.
They have got PRJs as well.
Yes, there's some coordinate system information.
Right. Which I guess we automatically support, don't we?
We do.
That isn't really what you wanted to talk about at this point.
No.
Okay.
Okay, so our format now is AutoCAD DWG.
Let's just, can you go back there? Because
yes.
Just highlight to folks, when we type, if you just type DWG again,
yes.
There's a lot of different ways of reading DWG, but one I wanted to highlight is that we can read Map3D object data directly. And that's one that isn't in the data interop, but is in FME, because we had to use some Autodesk technology and a little tip of the hat to our Autodesk friends for that. But if you're using Map3D, we can read and write that directly with FME. And Civil 3D, I think, is another one floating around. But right now, you're just using plain old DWG.
Yeah. Okay, so there's I've selected my format. Now I'm just going to browse to where that data is. So again, back in my FME data water folder. And I'm just going to go ahead. I'm just going to select all of these underscore LDWG files.
So you managed to select several of them there.
Yeah.
So what's going to happen?
So here we go. Let's take a look here.
Whoa.
And so when you see this indexing feature, so this happens when you first view a data set or you've edited a data set. And what it does is it speeds up subsequent viewing of the data. And once you hit refresh, it also removes the excess features.
The ones that didn't have data, the ones that we thought might have had data but didn't get flushed out of there.
Exactly.
So this is really, we can't actually tell where the boundaries were anymore
between
those tiles.
Exactly.
One thing I also want to throw in is that that understands wildcards there. So you could have said L star dot DWG.
Yeah.
And in fact, there's a weird notation where you go star star, and that will just drill down all the subdirectories. Basically, if you'd say C colon star star slash star dot DWG, you'd get every DWG in your whole computer. Did you know
that's
that?
That's right.
Have you ever done that?
I haven't done it very often.
We should do that right live in front of everybody. Wouldn't that be
maybe
fun?
Not today. Okay, so that's the FME connections node. So let's move on now, and we're going to talk about FME tools in our toolbox. Now, this is where we actually start to translate data rather than just view it. There are three tools available. The quick import means converting any FME-supported format into a file or personal geodatabase. By importing data this way, the full set of ArcGIS editing and geoprocessing tools can now be applied to the data. The reverse of this is a quick export. Quick export means converting a file or personal geodatabase into any other FME-supported format, such as CAD formats, CityGML for 3D data, KML for use in Google Earth, or PDF for non-GIS users to view. We'll first focus on the quick import and quick export, but for now, remember that the FME ETL tool is where most of the advanced data transformation occurs.
That's right. So while the quick import and export are handy, and you'll get a chance to see that, in many, many cases, it's way more important and valuable to be using the ETL tools. Mm-hmm. I also want to chime in and just mention the KML and PDF are two places where, in particular, the ETL tools really, really are valuable, and a lot of folks use this technology to tailor specific outputs in both KML and PDF.
Okay, so let's get into the quick import and export demo. So let's go back into our catalog, and we're going to locate our FME interoperability tools toolbox. So under system toolboxes, there is our FME interoperability tools. In there, we have our quick import and quick export. So we'll do the quick import first, and let's take a look at the data we're going to import. So back in our CFME data folder, we're going to import, so that property data that I mentioned before, the parcel MIF data.
Yeah.
So we've got lines in there, and if we identify one of these lines, we'll see that there are fields, but they're all blank.
Oh, that's no good.
But if we take a look at the points, notice we have attribution here.
What we have going on is that lines and points are cohabiting in the same file. Is that right?
Exactly.
Wow.
Exactly.
That wouldn't happen in the Esri world, would it?
And if you take
that
a look at the properties here, notice that there is a coordinate system on this data here. It's a state plane Texas coordinate system. Okay, so just a little bit about our source data. Always important to understand what it is you're working with. So back in our interoperability tools, now let's double click on quick import.
It's quick. It's double quick as well.
Okay, so our input data set again. Here's the dialog box we're getting used to now. We're going to select map info MIF for our source format. And our data set is that properties data, parcel K24. And we're just going to go ahead and hit OK.
Now, of course, you could put a star there, whatever, but all that stuff. But just this is enough. You're just going to do one?
Yeah. You'll see a bulk load a little bit later in the demos.
Okay.
Yeah.
So you're telling me just to kind of hold my horses?
Yeah. Okay, the output staging geodatabase, I've created a little webinar output folder here. We'll call it parcels.gdb. Okay. And I'm going to hit OK here. And let's bring up the geoprocessing results window so we can see when this is done. It'll just take a few seconds here. So we should get an output staging geodatabase soon. So that's pretty straightforward. And like I said, all you're doing is bringing information or bringing other data into the ESRI world. So here we have our output staging geodatabase. Let's take a look at our webinar output folder here in the catalog tree. There we go, our parcels folder. And we have our lines and our points there now.
So we really haven't changed the data model, because I bet if you look at those lines, they still have blank attributes.
Yes, exactly. So let's identify one of those.
You didn't make water out of a stone there?
No.
If there wasn't attributes to begin with, there still isn't afterwards.
That's right.
Isn't that funny? A lot of people like to blame FME when the data comes out and it isn't what they want instead of what was actually there to begin with. So
no, it's preserved the data exactly as it was.
Okay.
It's translated it.
But it was quick.
It was quick. So now that we've done a quick import, let's do a quick export. Okay, so quick export exports feature classes from a geodatabase into any other format. So let's take this parcels geodatabase that we just made and let's throw it out to KML. So I'm going to double click here back in the interoperability tools on the quick export button. Our input layer is that parcels geodatabase, the file geodatabase. And we will select, we'll go ahead and select both of these, lines and points, because KML is a format that's capable of handling multiple geometries per file. So we'll go ahead and select both of those. Our output data set, we'll just click on the browse here, select KML. And let's throw this in our webinar output folder as well. And we'll call this parcels.kml. And just hit OK there. So again, this is going to run, and again, we'll bring up that geoprocessing results window, and just wait a few seconds for this to finish up here. Okay, there we go. That was, again, quick. Let's go to Windows Explorer.
A lot of people don't know this, but the original names for quick import and export were simple import and simple export. But we thought that quick was better marketing name.
It's quick and simple.
Yes.
Yeah. Okay. So here we have our parcels.kml file. Let's just double click on it. We know what's going to happen here. We've got Google Earth coming up. It's going to take us right to our data set. Let's just...
What's it look like? It's in beautiful Austin, Texas.
Austin, Texas. And the points represent all of these push pins. And there you go. We've got our lot lines. And we've got...
See, right
points.
Now they kind of have ugly names on them, like KML 103.
Yeah.
I bet there's a way you can do better than that.
Yes, inside the FME ETL tool.
Right. So yes. if you're using these quick things, well, they're quick because you're not really being able to polish stuff up very much. Like a whole bunch of defaults are in play. But if you want to really refine things, then that's where, oddly enough, we'd use the ETL tool stuff.
Mm-hmm.
And yes, I do always want to make sure to thank our friends, the City of Austin. They were one of the first cities to make a complete data set available. Years and years ago, we found that, and that's the basis of much of the demo data here at SAFE. And I will say to them that we did convert that data to this gratuitous use of formats. Their data wasn't actually in all those formats to begin with, but I actually did that a long time ago.
Okay.
Did you know that?
I didn't know that.
Okay. Well, now 800 other people do, too.
Okay, so now let's move on to the nuts and bolts of FME, the FME ETL tool. So FME stands for Feature Manipulation Engine. It is a spatial ETL tool, and ETL stands for Extract, Transform, and Load. In other words, FME is a data warehousing tool for moving spatial data about. But not only can FME move data, FME can translate data to different formats, as we've seen, and also transform its data model in content, so the geometry and attributes, to meet a required output structure. It's a model-based solution, which means that once you create a translation, you can run it again as many times as you wish, and it has an intuitive-to-use graphical user interface that allows you to visualize the flows and transformations of data.
Right, so it's really a way to set up these things graphically, stuff you might otherwise write scripts if you even could do that. And then the other thing that folks often like to say is it's repeatable automation. Mm-hmm. So whether you're putting it inside of a model in Model Builder, which you totally can do, or if you have full FME, you can run it externally in batch files and so on. You basically set this stuff up once, publish some parameters in there, let them be adjusted, and you can use the model over and over and over again.
Okay, so let's do three demos. So the first demo I'm going to do is just a quick translation, and we're actually going to move data between two non-ESRI formats to start with. Then we're going to get into a little more of the transformation. We're actually going to take those lot lines and build polygons from those. And we're actually going to move the attribution from the points into the lots once we've built them. And in our third demo, we're going to do a bulk load to our geodatabase. And we're going to add some geometry validation to that tool.
Is that necessary, Mita? Is there data that's bad out there?
There is data that can be bad, believe it or not.
Nobody knows the trouble we've seen.
People, you don't have any idea the amount of problems that we've helped customers with for the last 15 years, bringing, honestly, a little bit of bad data or finding out what the bad data is so it can be corrected before going into geodatabase, because geodatabase is actually pretty particular.
Mm-hmm.
And so, yeah, we've really seen some trouble. So I'm excited to see how this is going to work.
Yeah, okay. Oops. Let's go back there and do the demos. Okay, so quick translation, MIDMIP to GML.
Now, is it quick, really?
It is a quick, well, yes.
Not as quick as using a quick. It's slightly less quick.
There's a few extra steps to set it up.
Right.
Not just a quick level click. There's a wizard you need to go through this time, but it's still quick. Okay, so to create, let me just make this a little easier to see. So under toolboxes, I created a new toolbox called FME ETL Tools Webinar. To create a new FME ETL tool, I right-click on that, go to the new item, and select FME ETL tool. Now, the first thing you'd be presented with is a wizard. So remember those property lot lines and points. Let's go ahead and select those again. So map info MIDMIP for our source format. We'll select the parcel K24 file from our FME data properties folder. And we'll select GML this time for our destination
format. I'm going to ask people to chime in. If you're a GML lover, let us know in the questions thing. I'm sure we're going to get flooded. And I know the GML lovers are going to be excited to know. Did you know this, Mita, that in September in Denver, there's going to be version 4 of GML
that's
going to be discussed. And I know everybody at SAFE is thrilled to death about that.
Yes, I'm sure our guru Juan is especially excited.
He's got job security for another 3 or 4 years.
Okay, so there we go. So that's basically what you enter in the wizard. So very simple, just information about your source and destination. Click Finish, and what's going to come up here, for those of you familiar with FME, is you're going to get the Workbench application. So there you go. You see it there. It's called an FME ETL tool, of course, inside of this extension. And here we go. We've got the details about our translation on the canvas here. And all we have to do now, actually, is run the translation.
So that is actually pretty quick.
Yeah. We can do that with the green arrow button here, or we can go to the File, Run Translation button. Now what I must enter here is where I want the destination GML file to be written. So again, we'll throw that in the webinar output folder. We'll call it parcels.gml.
You're getting a lot of interesting outputs in that folder.
Yeah.
That's what happens when you demo FME. And look at that. That symphony unfolded of all that log information. That was it's beautiful, really, to see.
Yeah, so the log gives you details about the transformation as it's occurring.
The only thing I'm a bit sad about was that the whole thing took only 3.3 seconds.
Hmm. Well, there will be some longer ones coming
up. Okay, good.
Okay, so we've got 849 features read. We've got 849 features written. And
it actually labeled it on that arc there, too.
It did, exactly. So that's a really good way to kind of keep track of what's happening in your transformation as it's running, or after it's run, you'll see these numbers. And it's a good idea of what might have gone wrong, actually, in your transformation, because if suddenly you only get one feature coming out of your transformation, you expected all of them, then you need to take a look at that.
Yes.
What we call a transformer. I'll explain that in just a second. But as Dale said, these numbers are a good thing to keep track of. Okay.
This is really a tool now that you've made. It probably is in your toolbox, actually.
Yeah.
So those that, if you're using full FME, these things are saved either in a toolbox or out on the file system as what we call an FME workspace.
Mm-hmm.
But if you're the data interop, then this is always a tool inside of the geoprocessing environment.
Yeah, exactly. And so this is it here, this ETL tool. Two is the one I've
which
just
can
created.
Be run just like any other geoprocessing tool.
Yes, exactly. Okay, so that's the first demo.
Did we actually get GML?
Oh, we did. We didn't check, didn't we? Did we? Okay, let's
I know
let's
that there's
go to
a lot of people out there
folder.
That are really excited to see it.
Okay, so there's our GML data right there. It's got a size, so do you need to see that it's actually there, or should I move on?
I think you're okay to move
okay.
on. I mean, we can save a little bit.
Okay.
We wouldn't want to spoil all the fun for everybody.
Okay.
And as well, I know that there's a lot of people excited about XSD files. That's the actual
yes,
schema.
Right.
So we won't show that either, but we did kick out an XML schema. Probably the easiest way to make an XML schema that you could possibly do.
Okay.
Because we didn't. Did you write any XML at all for this?
No.
You didn't. So FME did all the work.
FME did everything.
So big shout out to Juan for all of his hard work, I'd say.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. So now what are you going to do?
Okay. So now I'm going to build some polygons. So again, we're going to work with that same source data, but this time I want to put it to an existing feature class in my geo database.
Wow.
So remember, FME can be used to basically output data to the exact data model that you want.
Right.
So that's exactly what we're going to do here. I've already set up.
You've done it already. You've got
well, I've set up a feature class. We
okay.
have an Arc catalog. Now, this is in an SDE geo database. So I'm just going to open my connection here.
So tell us, Mita, what database is it sitting on top of?
It's not an Oracle spatial database.
You're like 40% of everybody
yeah,
else. Okay.
Yeah. So if we take a look at our lots here, just you know, briefly, I've set up a coordinate system on this, and I think I just went ahead with that same Texas State Plain coordinate system. We've got polygon features, so I'm
okay.
going to be building those lots, and I've set up a certain schema on this as well.
Okay.
Okay. So that's what I want.
Now, but is there data in there right now?
There's nothing in there right now. So if we preview
this,
there's
not lots of
nothing.
Data.
Yeah, nothing at all. We're going to load that data in with the FME ETL tool. Okay, so now I've already got an FME ETL tool. I've got the source already in here, so I'm actually just going to modify this one, and I'm going to change up the writer, get rid of the GML one, and add that geodatabase feature class.
Oh, okay.
So to get rid of it, I can write or click on the destination there.
Right,
and
this was GML.
This was GML.
So you're
going
to actually change this from being a GML output to being a geodatabase.
Yeah, exactly.
Okay. Well, this is going to be interesting.
Yeah, and I don't want the GML writer anymore in my workspace, so I'm just going to remove that as well.
It's
notice
gone.
In the Navigator window, I didn't point that out earlier, but the GML writer was in here. Notice on the reader is still there. And now to add another writer to my workspace, that's what we call it in FME, but here's the ETL tool. I can go to the writers menu and add a writer.
And I bet you can add... I mean, I know we're not going to do this, or I don't think we will, but you can have more than one writer.
Exactly. You can have multiple readers and writers.
What I've seen folks do before is add a writer like this that goes to where they really want to go, like the SDE, and add another one that might be some logging information, or in fact, maybe a QA report of the bad things that were encountered during the load that they can give back to the engineering department or whoever made the bad data to begin
exactly.
with.
Exactly. So again, I need to enter my connection parameters when I connect to the SDE Geo database, and I'm going to hit OK there. And I'm going to get this dialog box come up here, and it's asking me if I want to add a new feature type. A feature type in FME is the equivalent of a feature class in Geo database, and I'm going to say no here because, as you see, I already have one that I want to use, so I don't want to create a new one. Click no there. See here in our Navigator pane, we have our SDE Geo database writer now. So now let's add that feature class. So I go back to the writers menu, and this time I import feature types.
Right, because what you're saying is those things exist somewhere, and you want to just suck them in to avoid typing them in yourself manually.
That's right.
And I suspect you're only going to do one, but really you could pick like 30 of them.
Exactly.
If you felt like. Yep. Yeah.
Okay, so I've entered my connection details. I'm going to bring up the table list here. And once that comes up, I'm going to select that lots feature class that we just took a look at. Okay,
uh-oh.
Here we go. It's spinning.
Take a deep breath.
Yep. I hate seeing that not responding in the title there.
In the
title there.
Demo with like hundreds of people watching.
Right.
So I guess it's trying to go out there and pull in the definition of these feature types.
Mm-hmm,
and
then
what we would see... with luck,
yes.
is a list a list of the feature types. How many are in this database?
You know, there's only a few. There's only a handful, less than 10, I think.
Less than 10?
Yeah.
That is a bad sign.
Yeah, I think, what should we do here, Dale? Should we kill this and try again?
I think we're going to have to kill it and try again.
Okay. All right. Close it. Okay. So bear with us here. I'm going to start up, create that ETL tool again. Okay, so back in our toolboxes.
It's there.
It's still there, so let's right-click and just hit Edit. And that'll bring us back to where we were when I last saved it.
Maybe.
Hopefully.
It's thinking.
Yeah.
I think Mita's bucking to get a new computer.
That's taking a little longer than usual to come up there.
Yes. You know what? I'm wondering if maybe we should do my sneak peek right now.
Yeah.
Put me on the hot seat while Mita gets her computer
Let me get myself sorted out
rebooted.
Here.
So let's switch over. You know, I was going to do something at the end, but I'll do that right now. Okay. So I'm going to let you all see my screen, and I think I think that you'll be seeing that. Yep. So I was going to show an example of something coming in 10.1. So ArcGIS 10.1 is going to include the data interop 10.1, which is based on FME 2012, our latest release, which will be coming out in 2012. And so one of the things that we've done in FME 2012 is add a bunch of support for LiDAR and point cloud formats, which dovetail very nicely with the LiDAR and point cloud formatting format support that is inside of ArcGIS 10.1. So what I've got is a nice little example, and I know someone had asked the question earlier if we can read XYZ. In Canada we'd say XYZ, but I should probably say XYZ files. So if we take a look here at this directory, I've got this thing called snap demo input LiDAR XYZ, and just to take a peek at one of those files, this is what it looks like. It's an XYZ and an intensity. And so this is some LiDAR that that we were given. I'll take a look here, and in the data interop, this is data interop, if I have XYZ like this, I can actually preview these things as well. So they will preview without any configuration. So that's one of my ingredients, and I've got a whole mess of them. And the other thing that I've got is a DGN file that was a project site, that was a clipping polygon. This is the area that we really are interested in, that we're told we have to produce a LiDAR file for. And for added measure, we have an orthophoto as well. So those are my ingredients, and what I've been asked to do in the 10.1 scenario here is to produce, I need to produce an output LAS file, LiDAR file, that I'm just going to edit this thing to show you what it is. I'm producing a LAS file for the area of interest, and then in addition, I'm going to just for kind of being gratuitous, I'm going to throw out a 3D PDF as well. So I could make this tool offline, or ahead of time, which I've done, or I could have done it live for you, but I'll save some time by just showing you it. So I brought in this XYZ stuff as a point cloud. I used the star. I'm pointing to it there if you see my mouse pointer, the asterisk to say, give me everything in this directory. I'm bringing in the design file as my clipping boundary, and I've also brought in my JPEG. And so what I've done is I've read all of these into something called a point cloud combiner, because each one of these point clouds is one feature. We're trying to join them all up into one. Then I'm going to clip that, and I output it as a LiDAR file. In addition, so then I'd be kind of done the main part of the project. But then the second thing that I'm doing is I'm going to go ahead and bring in the orthophoto, take the resulting clip LiDAR, make a tin out of it, and then slap the relevant part of the ortho onto that tin using an appearance adder and output it as a 3D PDF. And because I'm feeling confident, I'm going to go ahead and run this thing live. And so we're reading all these points in. And it's the symphony is unfolding in front of my eyes down there. And stuff's happening. And so this time I'm actually outputting two different data sets, the LiDAR as well as the PDF. And there it is. It's all done in only 18 seconds. And I can look at the numbers of features that went by. The one I will point out, I read 20 point clouds initially up here, and then that turned into just one after the point cloud combiner, which I'd expect. So after I've done all that, if I look here at my output or my live directory, I've now got my project. There's the LiDAR file inside of ArcGIS. If I flip this to 3D, that's the last file that I can now give to my designer, whoever's going to actually work with this LiDAR, they now have that, and they can do their additional work. Maybe they'll contour it or do whatever processing they're going to do. But as well, in the output directory here, I will have my output PDF as well. So if I double-click on that, I can then see that I've made, in a few seconds, I'll hopefully see a 3D PDF. And there it is. And so this I can give to my, actually I can give this to my mother to inspect the project area, because I know that she has a PDF reader, and when she gets a PDF file, she clicks it, and then she can inspect this and do her analysis. So it kind of democratizes, I guess, the LiDAR to whoever we have. So there we go. We did the sneak peek a bit early while Mita figured out her issues, and I think we're ready to return.
Yeah, we're ready to roll again.
Okay, so that's all I'll say about the LiDAR stuff. If you're interested in that, go ahead and fire in some questions to our panel here. That's all coming in 10.1, and yes, we do produce the LASD file as far as the ArcGIS folks go, so it's instantly able to do it. And as my friend Bruce Harold will say, it's just magic.
All right. So here we go. Sorry about that earlier, but we are back in business. So I brought in the feature class from my geodatabase now. You can see it here on the right-hand side. The first thing I want to point out is the difference between the schema. So notice we have fields like lot on the source, but we have lot number on the destination. Parcel ID happens to be pin on the destination. So we're going to deal with that in a little bit here. But the first thing we're going to do is build those lot polygons. Now remember, there were points and lines in that parcel MIB-MIF file. So we need to separate the lines out of, away from those so we can build the polygons. And I have to use a transformer to achieve that. Now, transformers in FME are found in the transformer gallery at the bottom left here. If I expand the categorized view, notice we have a number of different kinds of transformers. We've got about 400 in total that do various types of transformation. And I'm going to throw a geometry filter onto my canvas to filter out the lines from the points. So I can add it in various ways, but I'm going to do what I'm used to, and I'm just going to start typing it on the canvas here. Geometry filter, there it shows up. I hit the enter button, and there it is on my canvas.
Right. I'll just chime in a little bit. One of the tricks about using this stuff is figuring out what transformers to use.
Yes.
And so there is a search button on the bottom left that Mita could use to find them. We do have a nice catalog of these. If you see us at a trade show sometime, you can get one from us. There's a PDF of that catalog on our website, which I'll ask our marketing team to inject into the follow-up materials. So if you want to just grab that, it makes wonderful late-night reading. And certainly you can wow audiences at cocktail parties with your knowledge of obscure transformers. Yeah. In fact, I'm waiting for that to be a thing on Jeopardy sometime. Mm. I'll take obscure transformers for 800, Alex, and you can ask what the neighbor color pair setter is or something like that. Anyway, geometry filter is interesting because, again, you have these lines and points cohabitating in there, and that isn't going to fly in an Esri world, is it?
Right, exactly. You have to separate them out. So here we go. Our lines are going to come out of the line port. The points are going to come out of the point port. So I can now deal with them separately. So let's build some of those polygons. And I know, having used FME for many years, that I need an area builder to do that. That's very intuitively named, area builder. And we're going to throw that down on the canvas. Now, a lot of these transformers do have properties in them, and you get to those by selecting the properties button. I'm going to just go with the defaults here, but it is a good idea to take a look at the property to see how you can affect the way the transformer works by giving it some parameters. Okay, so now I've added two transformers, but I have no idea what my data really looks like at this point, so it's a good idea right now to check to see what's happening. And I can do that by right-clicking on a transformer and connecting what's called a visualizer. So I'm going to throw that down. I'm going to run the translation. Now, nothing's going to be written to the geodatabase because notice it's not even connected up. I'm going to run it and just output the data to the FME viewing application. Now, I've popped the visualizer there after the area builder, but as you can see, you can really put it anywhere in your workspace.
You can even have more than one.
You have multiple ones. You can QA/QC as you go, and that's a very dark color, so let's just change it up. Maybe not. Anyway, let's just zoom in a little bit here, and I'm going to click on one of these, and voila, we have lots, we have polygons. We don't have any attributes yet, but we have polygons, so that's what I expected. So let's move on here. Next thing we want to do is get some attribution into those lots. Now, there happens to be a transformer called the point on area overlayer that will allow me to do that. Notice it has a point input port, so that's what I connect up from my geometry filter, and then I push the areas into the area input port.
And it's going to basically merge the attributes, isn't it?
Exactly.
So the points attributes are going to be transferred to the area,
yeah.
Just like that.
Yeah, just like that. So we'll run this in a second, but I'm going to do one more thing. Let's deal with the different schemas. Because right now we've still got the source schema that's going to try to be written to the destination, and that's obviously not going to work because the destination doesn't have the same field names. So an attribute renamer will allow us to transform our schema. And we'll connect up to the area output port. Let's connect that up.
Oh, there's lots of red arrows there that isn't matched.
Exactly. Only the plot is named the same. So let's go into the attribute renamer. We'll select the old attribute block ID, rename it to block number. Lot is now lot number. We've got land LU code on the source, which is now mapped to land use code. And we've got parcel ID mapped to PIN.
Okay.
Okay, so that looks a lot better.
Yes.
Okay. So now let's go ahead and run this translation. We're going to write it out now to our geo database. I'm going to click the run button. And we will confirm in a second what we have. So there you go. As you can see, you build your transformation from left to right. It's very logical. You basically take your data through whatever steps you need to get it to the form you want it to be in.
And you can watch these numbers too. 600 things went into mm-hmm. the area builder, 153 came out.
Yeah.
We must be short a few points. If 153, mm-hmm. You can put QA into this and check, okay, which areas had no points, we could output them other places.
Yeah.
The other thing I would chime in, if you don't like doing attribute renamers, you can put that schema renaming stuff into a spreadsheet, mm-hmm. for example, and there's just a variety of ways this scales and can be used to attack small and large problems.
Yeah. Okay, so let's go into our catalog now and take a look at our lots table. So back in our database, let's just reconnect here to mall and preview the lots. So
here
again, let's zoom in a little bit down here and let's do an identify. And there we go. We have the attribution we want and the schema we want, of course, is there and populated.
Very good.
Okay. So we're getting into some real transformation there, as you can see. But we're going to do a little more now. We're going to add some validation to that same ETL tool. And remember, there were multiple map info mid-mif files in that properties folder. So just to remind everybody, in that data folder, notice there were lots of parcel mid-mif files. So we're going to load all of them. Using that same FME ETL tool. So let's add those two things to our tool. Okay, so let's think about what kinds of validation we can do. Geometry validation is one of the kinds of validation we can do. So we can check for bad geometries here. I want to capture things coming out of the area builder that may not be well formed. And I can use an OGC geometry validator to do that. So the past features, the features that pass the validation test will continue through the sports space and be written. And then the failed features will come out of this output port. Now I could do a number of things with the failed output port. I could add some more transformers and try and fix the bad data. I could write it up to a file, as Dale, you mentioned earlier, and we could work with that file then and fix it in there. Right now, I'm just going to leave it alone, and we're just going to pass the good features through this workspace. Now, the next thing we want to do is that bulk load. So the first thing I need to do is select all of the parcel mid-mif files. So back in our Navigator window, we expand the mid-mif reader, double-click on the source map info mid-mif file, and I go to the Browse button, and all I have to do is select all of these files. I didn't hit my shift button there.
There we go.
Okay. There we go. They're all selected.
So they'll all be red, but I have to make sure now that this feature type on my canvas also passes all of them through. Right now, it's only going to pass parcel K24 through. But if I set up this merge feature type at the bottom here, and we'll just give it a wildcard as a filter, it will pass all of the files that I've read through the workspace. Okay, so let's do, oh, one more thing, Dale. Remember we've already put data in that feature class. Let's truncate that table before we load it up again. So back in my destination, so I did it quite quickly.
Yeah.
So if I go to my destination here, I right-click and go to properties, I can see my destination feature type property. There's my attributes. Now there's also a number of parameters I can set here, one of them being truncate table first. So we'll set that to yes.
You've got to use that with caution.
You do. And I'm just going to go ahead and run this. So this will take a little bit to run here.
So one thing I will mention while it's running is that this stuff here can all be packaged up and put behind something that we call FME server, where you could upload data through a web interface and then have it run through this type of validation and loading. And we certainly have examples of that, which allows people in the field to bring data in. You can also package these things into geoprocessing tools and deploy them inside of ArcGIS server as well. So you don't have to run them interactively like we're doing here. You set them up, you author them, and then you can use them in a variety of ways.
Exactly. Okay, so we've got almost 12,000 polygons written to that feature class. Let's take a look at our lots in our database. And refresh this first, and here we go, here's our lots,
oh, wow.
And look at that, and if we click on one of those, we've got the attributes
lot. And so okay. We just showed one kind of validation, but really the sky's the limit. You can put tests in and so on. I have a feeling there's a few of these that didn't have points, and I have a feeling that there's more than one point in several of them. So I think we're getting near the end here. What else do we have?
We are. Well, we've got another poll question right now.
All right. So, yeah, just to get a feeling, what kind of ArcGIS are you using out there? FME and the data interop are available on all of these. And certainly, we continue to support them. The FME itself, one installation of FME figures out what ArcGIS it is and does automatically and magically just work. So are we nearly done our thing? Aaron's going to close the polls off. Wow, lots of folks on 10, and I'm pleased to see almost nobody older than 9.2. That's good news for everybody involved.
Okay, so the last topic for demos is data distribution with ArcGIS Server. Now, so we're moving into the world of server. Now, FME server, the demo I'm going to show you, FME server is sitting underneath the ArcGIS server. So just to chat briefly about the FME server, what it does, it brings the power of FME to the enterprise server environment. It allows organizations to efficiently validate, share, and load large volumes of data. The capabilities of FME server can be used in conjunction with web mapping applications such as ArcGIS server, and that's what you're seeing here on this web page now. So I'm going to take advantage of the data download capabilities of the FME server. I've got four layers I can choose here to download. All I have to do is draw a polygon around the area I want to download.
We'll pick up some of the riot sites there.
Yeah, let's get downtown in there.
Okay, great.
There we go. I now enter some parameters. So I'm basically creating a request of the kind of data I want returned to me. I select the output coordinate system I want the data to be in. I select the output format. So we'll go ahead and stick with PDF here. And I want the bus routes and the bus stops. And now order my data. Now the FME server is taking my request and it's plugging away and it's giving me the results and it's here in a zip file.
I know that there's many out there wanting me to say clip, zip, and ship, and so I'll do that. Look at Mina, you haven't registered.
Sorry, Dale. Okay, there's my results.pdf, so nothing fancy, but I've got some bus routes and bus stops there.
Yes. Okay. So the bottom line is FME server is a web interface to it, and it's easy to make an integration with ArcGIS server to add clip, zip, and ship, or you can also do the data upload and validate type of scenario that Mina was showing earlier.
Exactly.
Now, we did our bonus early. Mm-hmm. So I think we're pretty much done.
Yep.
So just to kind of wrap up, you can either get the interop extension or the FME Esri edition. All the things that Mita showed work in either one of those things. if you have the ESRI edition, there's just one thing, Mita, can you fire up the integration console?
Sure.
Not a lot of people know that if you have full FME, if you want to inject it into ArcGIS, you might have to run that integration console. And so it's underneath the administration tools of FME and brings this thing up. And then from here, you can tell if you've been injected into ArcGIS or not. So that's the way to do that. So there's a bunch of other minor differences, but the bottom line is, as I said at the beginning, safe is happy, whichever one you support or buy, and if you want to, please buy them both. So so that's completely fine. We got a poll here just as we're wrapping up. Aaron's going to fire it up. And I think we got maybe even two more polls. Oh, yeah, this would be interesting. As we look at our roadmap for ways that we can extend the functionality, we'd really like to know how many of you care about some of these more advanced bits of functionality inside of the geodatabase. We can do some things, for example, with reading parcel fabric. There's a knowledge base. I think you were involved with writing
that.
Yeah,
that's coming.
Right, about ways to read parcel fabric. Like to know if anybody would like to load parcel fabric. Terrains come up once in a while. We don't really do that today. Dimensions, I think we do dimensions. We didn't say 3D data types, but that's because we already do that. So we can put building models and that sort of stuff in. And annotation is another one of these lifelong quests that no matter how much we do, there's always more to do. So anyway, should we close the poll on that? Oh, look at that. Well, pretty much they won it all.
Oh, yeah.
Is how I would summarize that. So thanks very much for, I guess, validating that we're hiring some more people for our database team. Let's see, what else do we have? Oh, look at that. If you want to rewatch to see how we reacted when something hung in the middle of our thing, you can watch that over and over again by reviewing the recording. I know Mita and I will want to watch that. How about you, Mita?
Definitely.
Yes.
Yeah.
So when we used the state-of-the-art 8-track for that, so we will be able to send you that link right afterwards. And you can also follow up by getting a trial of FME. We do a 14-day trial, or you can get a trial of the data interop extension. They give you 60 days. So that's something that Bruce and the folks at ESRI have done. And you can also contact us anytime for a web demo or have us dig into some more of your things. You can tune into upcoming webinars. There's one we run regularly that's just a general intro to desktop of FME, which would be applicable to data interop as well. Raster and FME, that's one of my favorite topics. Mita, do you like Raster?
Not as much as Spectrum.
Okay, but I like Raster, and so we're going to be talking about that on the 25th. You can do a lot of things there. And, of course, KML. I think you like KML, don't you?
I love KML.
Because I guess it's got Vector in it.
Yeah.
So you can tune in for that as well. And there's also recorded webinars. You can tune into the Community Maps one where you can hear Steve Grisey say, Raster? What's Raster? At the very end. But it was about using this technology to load community maps. And as well, Mita, you've done one about geodatabase only. I think we're just about to the end, but one more poll, which will maybe check who's willing to stay overtime. Is that what it says? So Aaron's going to bring up the poll. Oh, yeah, about different data types that we work with. So let us know on that so we can help focus our efforts. I know 3D is one we've worked on for many years. Not a lot of folks have been interested, but there, I feel a momentum shifting there. And, of course, LiDAR was a big initiative coming in 10.1 and FME 2012. So can we close the poll on that? Okay. Again, they pretty much won it all. So actually, good to see as many people wanting 3D as that. That validates our investments there. But, of course, CAD always kicks. Always kicks. All right. So what else do we have? Oh, our great win. Okay. So would you like to have a free FME desktop training? So... let us know, and we'll get you into that. And so we got, a bunch of seats that we're going to be giving out, either here in person. You can come to beautiful Surrey, or you can tune in online. One thing that I think we – are we going to ask the question about data interop? We've got another one coming up. Okay, so let's move on. Let's see about that. Look at that. Hardly anybody wants to come to Surrey. It really, it's a good place, isn't it, Mita? It's a wonderful place. Some of my best friends are from Surrey, actually.
Yeah.
So, and one last thing. We're looking at seeing if we might be able to do a specific ArcGIS data interop training. It would be in the cloud. We'd have to work with our friends at ESRI to get licenses for that. We would show you how to do this stuff in a bit more detail online. Let us know. If you're an FME customer, the stuff would apply equally as well, and we'd be focusing on doing geodatabase kind of stuff in that whole session. So, wow, I think a lot of folks wanting that, so we'll be working with our friends at Esri and trying to set that up and be in touch with you shortly. So I think, I know we've gone over time and people have things to do, but really we'll just wrap up with this. We'll be sending out some follow-ups. The group here at SAFE is ready to keep on answering questions as they come pouring in. I know there was lots of very interesting ones, and I really thank you for your participation. Nita, it's been a blast.
Thanks, Dale.
So I think with that, I think we're a bit over time, so we're going to just call that good. Again, keep on chatting with, I know Laura's sitting there anxious to answer more questions, I can tell, but thank you so much. And so from the Crystal Gondola here in beautiful, sunny Surrey, British Columbia, we're going to sign off and wish you a good rest of the day. Thanks very much.